I'm the executive director of TMA Bucks. We are the nonprofit transportation management association serving all of Bucks County. And I want to thank, of course, McMahon Associates for once again partnering with us on our the latest in our ongoing series of educational seminars. Now, first, a little bit about the TMA for those who may be unfamiliar. We are a member-supported organization. Now, if you've been to these before, you've heard me compare us to public radio or television because our services and our programs are available to everyone. But it's our members that make the operation possible because each dollar in membership is used as a local match, and we match and leverage four or oftentimes more dollars in federal funds that are put to work right here in Bucks County. Some of you are already TMA members, and to you, I sincerely thank each and every one of you for your ongoing support. If you are not yet a member, please become a member today. Go online to tmabucks.com. Take time to learn what we're all about. If you have questions, you can contact me. You can contact any member of my very capable staff for more information. Your membership is now more than ever critical to our success and our ability to continue doing the things that we're doing, including offering programs such as these. As our membership grows, so grows TMA Bucks. So please don't wait another day and help us to grow. And whether or not you're a member, tmabucks.com will regularly have information on projects, programs, and other relevant information in the world of transportation. I invite you to visit and check that out today. Now, a little addition just for today's webinar, golf. Now that I have your attention, please save the afternoon of Monday, May the 16th. Save it on your calendar, do it now, and please join us at the Bucks Club in Jamison for the TMA Bucks Foundation's annual golf outing. All proceeds from that outing fund scholarships for graduating high school seniors from Bucks County and also TMA Bucks traffic safety programming. And your support there makes an incredible difference. So please, May 16th, mark it off on your calendar and plan to join us. Now let's move on. We'll move on to building better bus stops, which is the reason we're all here today. Please note, certificates for professional development hours will be emailed to attendees following the conclusion of the program. So all trips on transit buses begin and end at bus stops. That's a reasonable statement. So bus stops understandably become a vital connection between transit service and the communities that transit serves. Ensuring that bus stops meet the needs of all riders, transit agencies, and the community is essential to provide quality, efficient public transportation service, moving riders where they need to go. Now, here's a fun fact. Bus stops are not handled by SEPTA. SEPTA is a public utility. They're charged with moving riders from point A to point B. Once you step off the bus, you step out of SEPTA's jurisdiction, unless, of course, you're at a rail station, but let's not split hairs here. Just as PECO delivers electricity to your home, at which point the wiring in your house becomes your responsibility, so too SEPTA delivers passengers to their destinations, at which point any stop facilities, or in many cases, a lack thereof, become the responsibility of some other jurisdiction. So here today to discuss bus stops and how to build them better is Natasha Manbeck. Ms. Manbeck has more than 17 years of experience in transportation planning and engineering, with a focus particularly on coordinating transportation systems and land use. She is a senior project manager with McMahon Associates, where she leads a broad range of transportation and planning and conceptual engineering products for government clients. Ms. Manbeck oversaw development of the Building Better Bus Stops Resource Guide for the Pennsylvania Public Transportation Association and PennDOT, and has previously served as the Director of Transportation Services for the Chester County Planning Commission and as a civil engineer for the District Department of Transportation in Washington, D.C. Ladies and gentlemen, I introduce Natasha Manbeck.
Great. Thank you. Good morning, everyone. And thanks to Steve and the entire team at TMA Bucks for the opportunity to talk about bus stops today. In addition to myself, we also have another bus stop expert. Mark Castle from SEPTA is also a panelist today. Mark has been integrally involved in all things bus stop related, and in particular, improving bus stop design for SEPTA. He worked with DVRPC closely on development of SEPTA's bus stop design guidelines, and also was part of the committee for development of this Building Better bus stop guide. So Mark is here today to help answer questions and chime in with SEPTA's perspective, since I anticipate many of the attendees today live and work and travel in SEPTA's service area. So with that, I'm going to share my screen and start the presentation. So maybe we'll start with a little visualization. You know, feel free to close your eyes and picture a bus stop that you have seen in your community. Maybe it's one you drive by, maybe it's one you use, but get a picture in your mind of a bus stop in your area, in your community. And what words come to mind? What do you see at that bus stop? Is it simply a sign on the side of the road, or are there connecting facilities? Do words like safe, accessible, comfortable, attractive, connected come to mind? The goal of the Building Better Bus Stops Resource Guide is to provide tools and resources to planners, designers, municipalities, transit agencies, and the entire village that works together on building better bus stops, with the goal of having bus stops that are safe, attractive, comfortable, convenient, and connected, as well as accessible. So the presentation today will be an overview of the Building Better Bus Stops Resource Guide, and it is available. The URLs are here, and I can get those into the chat so that you have direct links to those. So a little background on the development of the guide. Over the past several years, there's been increasing interest and need for more proactive bus stop planning. There's been several public transportation agencies that have been working in their communities on better coordinating transit and land use. And some of that includes development of bus stop design guidelines. I've already mentioned and referenced that SEPTA, in partnership with DVRPC, developed bus stop design guidelines and has updated those as recently as 2019. And SEPTA's guide is a great resource and is, you know, your go-to for bus stop design information in SEPTA's service area. In addition to SEPTA, the Port Authority in Pittsburgh also developed bus stop design guidelines for their service area. Those guides were kind of specific to the needs of those transit agencies. And so Building Better Bus Stops Guide was developed because there's somewhat limited guidance beyond SEPTA and the Port Authority for the other 30-some transit agencies that operate in Pennsylvania. And so PennDOT, as well as the Pennsylvania Public Transportation Association, or PPTA, identified that gap and decided to support and partner on developing the Building Better Bus Stops Guide. So the purpose of the guide, first and foremost, is to have people think about and incorporate transit upfront in the planning process. I use this example, and this happens often, is a new development, whether it's a warehouse, a shopping center, a senior housing development, any type of development that may have transit trips is developed. But there's no transit that's considered as part of the land development or planning process. And it gets built, and the owners or the residents or the employees are saying, hey, we need transit to serve this location. And they'll contact the transit agency. And oftentimes the site itself hasn't been designed to incorporate or consider transit, and it just doesn't work. And the transit agency can't really serve that location. So the idea is to think about transit upfront and make smart decisions and strategic decisions about how to design and incorporate transit in municipal plans, policies, as well as land development efforts. One of the themes you'll hear me say throughout the presentation is the importance of partnerships. And Steve alluded to this in his introduction, is that, you know, there's a lot of entities that are involved and have various roles and responsibilities with regards to bus stops. The transit agencies are one, but they're not solely responsible for bus stops. And municipalities, property owners, developers, and PennDOT all have a role to play and can make contributions to building better bus stops. So the guide was developed to provide resources and help to educate the world of planners, engineers, municipal officials, and transit agency representatives. The guide was developed over the course of 2020 with an input from broad stakeholders. I already referenced the technical advisory committee. We also did some research, national research, particularly for bus stop design in rural and suburban communities, which is often not a focus of other bus stop design guidelines. The full resource guide is available on both on PPTA and PennDOT's website. So I first want to stress that the guide has resources, tools, best practices, but it's not intended to be a design standard or have design requirements. I will reference that PennDOT is in the process of updating their design manual and will have a chapter on transit facilities. So that's another upcoming resource that will be available for design related issues. The guide is focused on planning and design for fixed route bus stops, but I think some of the tools could be applicable for other types of transit and considering, for example, paratransit. We did focus on areas somewhat outside of SEPTA and the Port Authority because they already have their own guidelines. But one element that I'll focus on today is municipal planning and policy resources. This is something in the Building Better Bus Stops Guide that wasn't necessarily part of either SEPTA or the Port Authority's guide and are applicable across the state. So many bus stops in Pennsylvania look like the images shown here, and they're simply a sign on the side of the road, sometimes hard to find, which is why I had to circle them on the screen. They lack sidewalks and crosswalks. It's difficult to safely walk to or from the bus stop. There's often limited space and infrastructure for waiting passengers. However, we know that enhanced bus stops are relatively low cost and can have a significant impact on safety, accessibility, ridership, and even transit operations. So the guide provides tools to solve some of these common bus stop challenges. And I will emphasize at this point, bus stops are challenging. And if we have any designers and planners on the line, I encourage you to get involved with bus stops because they are design challenges and require a lot of creative solutions. As I referenced, one of the key challenges and opportunities to bus stop is that they involve a number of partners. And one of the key themes is that interagency coordination and partnerships is what's critical for good bus stop planning and design. So we have municipalities in Pennsylvania that control land use. We have transit agencies who operate service. PennDOT owns roadways, the state roads, but they also play a critical role in funding public transit. MPOs and RPOs work with PennDOT and transit agencies on long-range plans and funding. Developers, planners, engineers, and design professionals are the ones who help to transform places into something new or different. And community members are the ones who are utilizing and riding the bus. So we all have a role to play in bus stops, and they're only improved as a result of partnerships and collaboration. So now I'll move into a brief overview of the guide. It's organized into three parts, and that will be how the rest of my presentation is organized. So part one is focused on planning and policy resources, and it includes both model ordinance language and a plan review checklist. Part two is focused on design resources. Part three has bus stop typologies, or eight different somewhat common types of bus stops, and some graphics to show potential bus stop designs. And there is also a quick reference. So the guide has a lot of great information, but if you are coordinating with a municipal elected official or a community member, we do have a quick reference, which is a 10-page summary document that gives some of the highlights from the guide. So I'll kick it off with part one, which is planning and policy resources. And this is really geared towards municipalities, as well as transit agencies, MPOs, RPOs, and planners who are involved in developing various types of transportation plans, policies, and ordinances. So we've talked about municipalities. In Pennsylvania, have the power to plan and regulate land use, and transit agencies are responsible for planning and operating transit services. And those roles are separate, but land development and design really directly impacts transit service and ridership, which is why it's important for transit to be considered in local plans and policies. Like all modes of transportation, public transit is all about the people, and public transit inherently links the people it serves to the places they want to go. Transit in particular is heavily influenced by aspects of land use, including density and design. In some locations, transit just might not be a viable or cost-effective option because of the land use patterns. And so municipalities can encourage development and design that really fosters public transit as an option and provides numerous benefits to the community and to their residents. The resource guide includes tools and resources to consider transit up front. Transit can be incorporated into almost any plan that the municipality might be developing, particularly a comprehensive plan or any other planning document, even an open space plan or an active transportation plan. In addition, transit should be considered and incorporated into ordinance language, and we'll talk about that a little further. The resource guide highlights key steps for incorporating transit into plans. And it should be at every step in the planning process. So upfront, when you're evaluating existing conditions, you should know where your existing stops are and routes are, and who are the potential riders, frequency of service, and current ridership. As you start to think about future needs, it's important to understand demographic trends and how that might influence transit needs and ridership. And then coordinating with the transit provider on recommendations and what future needs might be for transportation and transit services. The resource guide also summarizes some of the best practices for transit supportive land use and design. And this includes big picture things like focusing growth on transit corridors, but also small items such as having connected pedestrian facilities within a site. You can see on the images on this screen, the importance of the sidewalk within the site to connect pedestrians to the bus stop facility. which is something, you know, relatively small, relatively low cost in the scheme of projects, but something that is very critical to making bus stops safe and accessible. So for one of the things that's really important to think about is how land use patterns and design can impact the efficiency and quality of transit service. So if you think of a key transit corridor, and if the design of the developments along the corridor is not oriented towards transit, sometimes buses might have to divert into a site and circulate to provide access. And that then makes for longer trips for everyone that's using the bus. So if you can have buildings oriented towards the roadway and connected pedestrian facilities, it will allow the bus to stay on the main corridor and allow people to walk to their final destinations. So one of the resources in the guide that I think is pretty exciting is the model ordinance language. As part of our research, we looked across the country and did not find any model ordinance language relative specifically to bus stops. So we developed the model ordinance language both for zoning as well as saldo, and it has clear definitions for common elements of bus stops. So if you're going to be coordinating with a developer and asking them to provide a bus stop, you want to make sure that you know what you're asking for and that you are getting the design that is accessible and meets current design standards and also works for the transit provider. The model ordinance also has guidance on the location and design of bus stops. And one important thing is requiring coordination with transit agencies. Just like if you're developing on a state road, you coordinate with PennDOT for an HOP. If you're developing along a transit corridor, it's really important to reach out to the transit agency to figure out whether or not a bus stop is there, should be moved, should be enhanced, and how that might impact your plan and design. The model ordinance language will need to be modified and tailored for the specific needs of a community, but I think it's a really strong foundation to permit and encourage bus stop infrastructure in appropriate locations. And thanks to Mark and some of his efforts, I believe that Lower Marion Township has incorporated, so if you want to see a fresh example, they have bus stop model, use the model bus stop ordinance and incorporate it into their draft saldo. I believe Susquehanna Township out close to Harrisburg has done the same. Additionally, the resource guide includes a plan review checklist, and it reflects the requirements in the model ordinance. So if you're a planner or designer and you want to make sure you're meeting all of the design requirements, it's a great tool. I will say that SEPTA has used the model plan review checklist and develop their own. So if you're in SEPTA service area, I encourage you to go to SEPTA's Transit Supportive Community Development website, which is listed here. And there you can find a copy of SEPTA's Better Bus Stop Review Checklist. And I encourage you to use that as a great tool and resource as you're considering and reviewing plans related to bus stops. I'll pause there and ask if Mark, if you want to chime in on anything before I move on to the design.
No, I guess the main points that I would like to make are one, that I'm not aware of anything specific in the municipality's planning code that requires outreach to a transit agency. But what I will say is that it's good practice. And while there are a number of entities that can be triggers to contact us, PennDOT Connects efforts, highway occupancy permits, traffic impact studies, County Planning Commissions through their Act 247 reviews have also been a trigger. We encourage everyone that's involved in the design world to not rely on someone else to be the trigger. And the reason I say that is twofold. First of all, there's an opportunity, quite frankly, in the development process to save time, money, and effort if these issues are addressed upfront, because it doesn't become an 11th hour request by the transit agency to address a particular situation. And we're required under Federal Transit Administration guidance that in the event that a bus stop is either new or relocated, that we need to make the ask of the people that control the right of way to make these kinds of improvements. So there's value in doing it up front. It also indicates to the residents of a community that transit is an important mode, that investment is valued, investment is present. It heightens the awareness that there are services available. And so as a way of implementing a comprehensive plan, where there's a lot of conversation about multimodalism and transit as an option, it's actually a way for municipalities to take a step to implement the terms of their comprehensive plans. So those are the two things that I would make as a point at this point in time.
Great, thanks, Mark. So, you know, a lot of people say, well, it's great to have plans, but I really want to know, how do you implement the plans? So, and Mark kind of alluded to this, one of the most efficient and cost-effective ways to incorporate bus stop improvements into the design and construction of adjacent either transportation improvement projects or land development projects. So the top image is a shelter that was installed as part of an adjacent land development, and that was at no cost to the municipality or the transit agency. And so that shows how, you know, it's a minor investment and some coordination up front can lead to a really great looking stop. For PennDOT transportation improvement projects, PennDOT Connects process really promotes the collaboration of partners early, and it's a great opportunity for municipalities to advocate for transit improvements to be considered and potentially incorporated into the PennDOT improvement project. Some public transit agencies and municipalities have agreements with vendors, such as advertising agencies, to promote bus stops through public-private partnerships. That's just one example of public-private partnerships. The bottom image highlights another example of a partnership. It's a shelter that was purchased and donated by a local Rotary Club, and then the municipality agreed to maintain it. So you can see just from these couple of examples, there's a lot of people who can get involved and really support better bus stops and bus stop amenities. In addition, there are a variety of federal, state, and private grants that can be available to implement bus stop improvements, and those are highlighted in the guide. So now I'll segue to bus stop design, and you get a crash course on some of the design principles. This is part two of the guide, and it is really geared towards transit agencies, PennDOT municipalities, developers, and engineers who may be involved in the design of roadways, development sites, or other transportation infrastructure. And just to stress once again, any design should be done in close coordination with the transit agency, as well as the owner of the roadway and potentially the adjacent property owner. Bus stop design directly impacts public transportation riders in terms of accessibility, safety, comfort, and convenience. But the design, as I mentioned, also impacts the quality, efficiency, and cost effectiveness of service and operations overall. each bus stop is unique and the design must consider the site-specific context. So the resource guide has a lot of great information, but you can't point to any one picture and say, this is the bus stop design for this location. You have to consider all of the things that are going on at that location and, you know, really apply your best planning and engineering experience and judgment. So the guide does include some steps for planning and designing bus stops. And, you know, first is identifying the need or the potential, and that can be as part of a PennDOT or other municipal transportation improvement project, a land development project, or maybe a community request. So you have this need, and then you have to evaluate, is this the right location? And that process must be done in coordination with the transit agency. One thing I want to emphasize is that even if a transit agency says, we're not able to serve this potential site, and it might not be either feasible or necessary based on current conditions, there is even the opportunity to maybe reserve some right-of-way or provide supportive pedestrian infrastructure so that things change. And if, you know, ridership or other conditions might change, that you're still set up to support transit maybe at some point in the future. And then, you know, if there is agreement from the transit agency that it is a good bus stop location, you can move into the design process, which involves further coordination with the transit agency and the road owner and thinking about bus stop placement and configuration, which we'll talk about, and then some of the elements and amenities. One item to stress is that upfront in the planning process, you have to also think about maintenance. But a lot of bus stop infrastructure may require maintenance agreements. And so you want to think about that upfront before you get to the end and don't have an entity that's able and in agreement to maintain the facilities. The guide touches on evaluating potential bus stop locations and a host of factors to consider. While one location might be attractive for one reason, there might be other reasons that it's undesirable. And so there's a list of questions to consider in the guide. There's some other siting and design considerations. The design of a bus stop must be based on the transit vehicle that will serve the site. And in Pennsylvania, 35 to 40 feet is the typical size of bus stop or buses. So some of the dimensions in the guide, all of them are kind of based on that 35 to 40 foot bus. But it's why another reason why it's important to coordinate with the transit agency to understand what vehicle might be serving the stop. Some of the other considerations include driveway and access management, if there's bike lanes, whether there's going to be any pavement markings, as well as traffic signals and even roundabouts. You want to be thinking about the bus circulation and potential stop locations. So let's talk about some bus stop design basics. First, bus stop placement. It refers to where the bus stop is located with respect to an intersection, and there are three basic locations. Far side, which is after proceeding through the intersection, near side, which is before the intersection, and then mid block, which is you guessed it, in between. Bus stops can also be placed off of a public roadway and within the site of a transit center or another generator. And that information about stops within a site is included in the guide. I will say that far sides are typically preferred by most transit agencies because they minimize conflicts between buses and vehicles and also allow pedestrians to kind of cross behind the bus. There are locations where near side or mid block stops are appropriate. There are several different bus stop configuration options, and this impacts how riders get on and off the bus and also how the bus integrates with the roadway and the streetscape and really the surrounding environment. So curbside or roadside stops are the most common, and they're located along the side without any modifications to the edge of the roadway or the curb. And some key considerations for roadside stop include, you know, what's your available curb length for a bus to pull to the curb? What's the pedestrian and ADA access? And what are the traffic volumes and speeds to think about the bus's operation pulling to the curb and re-entering traffic? Curb extensions are bus bulbs have an extension of the curb line, and you can see in the picture in the center, one of the benefits is it gives additional space for things like shelters. But it also, the bus stops in the travel lane, which is good for bus operations. It's a lot easier, but it can impact and delay traffic. Bus bays or pullouts or turnouts include a designated area for bus stops that doesn't block the travel lane. And they're typically considered for higher volume or higher speeds, and where the bus stop might need to dwell for a longer time. And I will say SEPTA's bus stop design guideline has a lot of information regarding designs for bus bays. So this slide highlights some of the basic elements. Once you know where your stop is at, and you have to think about what are some of the features for the bus stop itself. And so I'm going to go through each of the bus stop elements in a little bit more detail. But one of the things I want to stress is that the graphic here and other graphics you'll see, they show one bus stop, but bus stops work in pairs. They are like shoes. You need two of them typically. So you want to think about someone, if they're going to take the bus to a location, they're probably going to take it home or the reverse trip, and they have to get on in the opposite direction. And so you want to think about that you have two bus stops and how they work together and the pedestrian access between them. And that's really important. So let's start with the ADA loading pad. That is one of the fundamental accessibility requirements for a bus stop. And it's a firm and stable surface, typically concrete. And the dimensions are 5x8. And if you think about being a bus stop operator and having to curb a bus in a 5-foot area, you can see why a wider pad might be desirable in some locations. It also provides a little bit more space for passengers to wait. Most of the times, you might not notice an ADA loading pad because it's just integrated and part of the sidewalk. And you can see that in the example here. You wouldn't, aside from the red highlight that I added to the side, you wouldn't look down and say, oh, there's an ADA loading pad. It's just part of the sidewalk. One thing that's really important is an ADA loading pad is not an ADA curb ramp. And this is where terminology and definitions are so important. The picture on the right is an example where a developer was supportive of providing a bus stop improvement, and the transit agency said, we need an ADA loading pad, and the designer put in an ADA curb ramp. And that doesn't work for ADA because the purpose of the ADA loading pad is to provide an area for the bus vehicle's ramp to be deployed. So as you can see in the pictures at the bottom, it's easy for someone who may be in a wheelchair or have other mobility needs to get on and off the bus, and that the ramp from the bus meets ADA slope requirements. If you're not at curb height, that ramp from the bus is much steeper. So you would prefer the ADA loading pad to be at curb height and not be a depressed curb. There are a number of configuration options, whether you have a grass buffer area or not. So again, it's just, I think of it as part of an extension of the sidewalk. Beyond the ADA loading ramp or loading pad, another, you know, basic element is a sign. That's what most bus stops have today. And it's typically provided by the transit agency. And you just want to make sure that it doesn't obstruct the pedestrian route and that it's away from the curbway, the curb edge or roadway. There's a number of different amenities that can be provided at a bus stop, a shelter, a bench, bicycle parking. One of the things I want to stress is not all bus stops need a shelter. It really depends on ridership. And, you know, while shelters are great and they can be a community asset and they can help with visibility, it isn't necessary for every stop. The bus stop design Building Better Bus Stops resource guide has information about the siting of shelters and what you can consider to make sure that they're accessible. You do need to provide an ADA accessible route between the shelter and the ADA loading pad. You also want to think about how pedestrians travel through the stop to reach their destinations and make sure that you have a pedestrian accessible route. One thing that's become a little bit more important due to COVID is having a clear zone for rear doors. So most transit vehicles have a rear door and it's typically used for people to get off of the bus. And you don't want people to get off into a tree or landscaped area. So it's preferred to have a level area that's free from obstructions. Another role that municipalities play in bus stops is designating no parking areas. It could be signs, painted curbs, or other pavement markings, but it's really critical to have an accessible stop that the bus can actually pull to the curb. And as I showed in those pictures, deploy the ramp. As you can imagine, if there's vehicles parked at the bus stop, it's not a very safe and accessible site and operations for the bus. Finally, it's important to have a safety buffer between the end of the bus stop and a driveway or intersection. So you don't want a bus that's stopped to be blocking an intersection. I already mentioned some of the other amenities that can be provided at a bus stop. I will highlight here, you know, the picture on the screen is a play stop that's in York, and it was funded through a grant that supports playground type of equipment. And they incorporated it into the bus stop. And so you can see it's not only an asset for transit riders, but it's also a community space. And I think thinking creatively about bus stops will allow more ideas like this to come to fruition. I already stressed the ongoing maintenance and that you should have agreements in place for the bus stop infrastructure and amenities. There's some simple things like emptying trash if there's a trash can or removing graffiti or some seasonal maintenance. But if you have something like a shelter, you also have to anticipate they can be hit and damaged. Panels can be destroyed. So you have to have some agreements in place to make sure that that shelter is maintained. The other thing I'll point out is that for shelters within PennDOT right-of-way, PennDOT has a transit shelter right-of-way placement agreement. And that's also something to consider upfront in the process. I'd like to close out the presentation and hopefully leave a couple more minutes for questions. So I'm going to show some of the bus stop typologies, which are in part 3 of the resource guide. These are renderings and graphics with notes of design treatments for bus stop configurations. They reflect different community contexts. As you'll see here, we have some that are for more rural or suburban stops and some for more urban stops. And while they don't cover every type of bus stop and all of the aspects of design, they highlight some of the common elements and configurations. So I'll start with this example, which I think is somewhat unique. It's a rural or suburban stop in an area where there might not be sidewalks today. And, you know, there's a lot of locations where the bus stop today is a sign on the side of the road, maybe in a ditch or on an embankment. And the thought is, you know, you might not be able to provide connecting sidewalks everywhere, but at least providing a safe and accessible stop is important. And the key element to that is the ADA loading pad. So I think a better visual of this is kind of a plan view or a elevation 3D view and an actual picture that shows a concrete pad, a level surface that meets that 5x8 requirement, and it allows an area for someone to wait for a bus, or if they get off the bus, they can then travel into the public right of way, which in this case might be the shoulder of the roadway. Somewhat similar and more preferred is to do a curb height ADA loading pad. I talked about the benefits of providing the ADA loading pad at curb height. And if you do that, it requires a little bit more infrastructure because you need a ramp down from the loading pad to a landing area that then someone can enter the public right of way. So again, a 3D view, you can see someone would get off of the bus or wait for the bus at the loading pad and then the ramp to access the public right of way. And here's a picture of a stop that's similar in terms of that design. So much preferred, although, you know, those stop designs are for kind of isolated locations. In all cases, it's always preferred to have a connecting sidewalk that will link riders and other community members to their destinations. So this shows, think of a commercial development. It could be a fast food restaurant, it could be a retail center, any of those things. At a very minimum, you want to provide a sidewalk to the bus stop and the ADA loading pad. I will say it would be even more preferred to provide pedestrian connection internal to the site to get people from the sidewalk to the front door. And that's mentioned in the guide. This is a typical far side stop in a more urban or suburban environment. So, you know, I would say this is maybe one of the more common types of bus stops. You can see a far side with an ADA loading pad, and this is a basic stop. There's no amenities, but you can see it provides that accessibility and the pedestrian connections. This is an example of a near side stop with a bump out. And we called this enhanced because we show a shelter, there's bicycle parking, there's lighting that can be provided. You can see how this bus stop can really be integrated into the community streetscape. And one of the things we did focus on in the guide is stops within a site. So whether that's a warehouse, a hospital, a senior center, a major shopping centers. There are times when it may be appropriate for a bus to divert into a site. And you really want to think about where that bus stop is located, how that bus or transit vehicle circulates through the site, including turning radii for that. And we present some different options for potential bus stop locations and some of the key considerations to make sure that you're making the stop convenient, but not putting it in a location that poses conflicts with other pedestrian and vehicular activity. So given the time and that we only have about 10 minutes left, I think I will wrap up and say, hopefully this guide and presentation will help you to take a role in building better bus stops. And I'll be happy to answer any questions. And I think Mark is available as well.
All right. Well, thank you, Natasha and Mark. And I have one, there's some questions popping up in the in the chat box here. Kathy Horwat from Langhorne Borough states, Langhorne Borough is home to two SEPTA bus routes. We have one bus stop at the Mayor's Playground and built and maintained by the Langhorne Rotary Club. Other stops lack shelters given no one wants the liability. PennDOT is currently redesigning improvements for US 1 RC3, but they do not include any shelters or lighting. What can we, Langhorne Borough, do to improve the safety for our transit residents?
That's a great question. Glad to hear there's a good stop.
Yeah. First of all, I think we need to connect directly with Langhorne Borough to try to, so much of this is context sensitive. So, and I think Natasha spelled that out in her presentation that, you know, for example, some bus stops at ends of lines are primarily where people get off, whereas other stops are where people are waiting, and trying to evaluate that, having ridership numbers, that kind of information is important to the context of how a particular site is designed. SEPTA's capital budget and policy really doesn't allow us to be the one to put it in, but we certainly want to be part of the process and identifying partnerships, identifying funding, identifying ways to make improvements. So I would be happy to get Kathy's information and reach out to her directly in that regard. Because the liability, I've been dealing with some liability issues in a number of municipalities, and that is a real issue. I think where that liability can in turn be transferred to a developer. I cite an example that recently came up in Chester County where that exact thing happened, might be a way to address this. But I don't know the specifics of this case, so it's probably best that we try to address it directly with the borough.
Mark, I will have my staff facilitate that discussion.
Okay, great.
I don't see any other questions at this point. I did see Dave Walter from my staff points out that you can check out the Complete Better, Building Better Bus Stops Resource Guide, and he does provide the links to that on the PPTA site, the PennDOT, or get a PDF from the PennDOT site, and those links are provided in the chat box. And also noting that a complete recording will be uploaded to our YouTube page and shared on tmabucks.com and our social media accounts in the near future. And one thing that I do want to point out in terms of shelters in Bucks County, specifically passenger shelters as they relate to bus stops, that can sometimes be a little bit more tricky, as Mark kind of alluded to in his remarks. It's really if you've seen one bus stop, you've seen one bus stop. I don't think any two are alike. And the farther you get into the suburbs, the more that becomes true. If there are issues relating to bus stops, and in particular with shelters, these are all things and discussions that TMA Bucks can help you in facilitating. So by contacting me or contacting one of the members of my staff, we can help to bring the parties together and get that conversation going. So it's something important to keep in mind going forward.
Steve, while we're waiting for any additional questions, there were a couple points related to Natasha's presentation that I wanted to highlight if I could. The dimensions of the loading pad that Natasha talked about relate to the ability of a person in a wheelchair to be able to maneuver from the bus, get off of that ramp, and then maneuver to the adjacent pedestrian pathway, sidewalk, trail, whatever the case may be. So those are within the U.S. Access Board guidelines. So we're taking something that's commonly understood in the ADA design community and incorporating it into bus stops. The value of having that loading area being at curb height as opposed to at street level or a depressed curb is, and I think Natasha mentioned this, but I recently came up with some numbers. There was a study that was done in terms of the ramp slope from the bus, comparing a street level drop of the ramp to a curb height. And the difference was markedly different. So this particular study found that the single digits of times when a ramp was dropped at curb height was the slope not meeting ADA standards. When you do it at street level or at a depressed curb level, it went up to between 55 and 65%. So you can, in this particular case on the right, where you have a loading pad that's designed for ADA, but the ramp, rather than the proper access to that loading pad, you're changing the ability to meet ADA standards by about 50%. And Natasha also mentioned lighting. One of the things that's really important to consider is that during significant times of the year, during our peak travel periods even, but we have people that work nights and overnights in some communities as well, the operator needs to be able to see that a person is waiting for the bus in order to make sure that they don't stop at every bus stop unless they can identify that there's someone waiting there to be picked up or someone requests that they'd be let off at that particular stop. So pedestrian scale lighting that allows the operator to see the person waiting is important. So coordinating with your municipal lighting standards, with PICO or whatever your utility is important in that context as well. And ultimately the location of bus stops, we evaluate them not only from pedestrian access, but we have to evaluate them from the safety of the vehicle being stopped at a particular location. So we work with our operations staff very closely in identifying locations that are appropriate for bus stops. And they ultimately make those decisions for SEPTA because they have to deal with them in a safety and operational standpoint on a daily basis. So there's a certain amount of coordination that takes place internally in addition to coordination with the municipality, the developer, the traffic engineer, the design engineer. And so again, I stress the idea that early in the process is better for us because we can address these issues hopefully at reasonable timeframes and reasonable cost so that in the end we create win-win situations.
Thanks, Mark. All points well taken. And in the spirit of corrections, I do want to clarify somewhat, I should say in clarifications, I want to clarify a little on something I said early on, which is that, you know, SEPTA has nothing, I feel like I implied that SEPTA has nothing to do with bus stops. They don't operate them or install them, but they do have a say in where they go. And I think that point was made abundantly clear by both Natasha and Mark. I just don't want anyone to go away thinking that they can just erect a shelter or erect a bus stop and suddenly a bus is going to appear there or start to stop there. There does have to be some conversation with SEPTA, and you know, perhaps an obvious point, but one that I feel the need to make nonetheless. And I do not see any further questions in the chat box at this point in time. So I'll remind anyone that's here for a couple of items. If you are getting a professional development hour, that certificate will be emailed to you at some point following this presentation. Our next webinar event is going to be on Wednesday, February the 23rd at high noon. This is going to be a partnership with us, with TMA Bucks, the Partnership TMA, and the Bucksmont Collaborative to learn about SEPTA's reimagining regional rail plans. And you'll have an opportunity to share your ideas and needs for Bucks and Montgomery counties. There is a registration available for that at tmabucks.com. And with that, take one more check for questions, and seeing none, that will conclude this event. Thank you all for attending, and we look forward to seeing you at our next event in February. And my thanks again to Natasha, to Mark, and to Eric from McMahon for helping to support this series of webinar events.
Yeah, thanks again for the opportunity, Steve.
All right. Take care, everyone. Thank you.
Thank you.